Let's go, girls.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Feminist Cocktail Hour. I'm JC, and today we are making an Aviatrix in honor of the Queen of the Skies, Amelia Earhart. To make this cocktail, you are going to need some gin, some cherry bourbon, some lemon juice, some rose water, and an egg white. While you go wrangle all that up, I'm going to get started with the story of Amelia Earhart. Amelia was 10 years old in 1907 when she saw her first plane at the Iowa Fair. She was underwhelmed. She said that the biplane was a thing of rusty wire and wood and not at all interesting. From the time she was a child, Amelia was a tomboy. She and her little sister Muriel would spend their days catching toads and bugs, hunting rats with rifles, and just body slamming their sleds down hills while they ran around their lawn in their bloomers. This freedom was thanks to their mother, Amy, who was very liberal-minded and wanted all the same opportunities for her daughters that she saw boys having. She encouraged them to be well-read and sought out an education that focused on math and science, which many educations afforded to girls in those days didn't emphasize. Still don't emphasize today. Now, on the other side of things, Amelia's father was sort of this listless lawyer who her mother's well-to-do family didn't approve of at all. He struggled to hold a job, and the family ended up moving from Kansas to Des Moines to St. Paul to Missouri to Chicago, all before Amelia was in high school. But through all of that, Amelia stayed focused on the big picture. She wasn't sure what she wanted to do with her life, but she knew she wanted to do something great. She kept this big scrapbook of newspaper clippings focused on women who were making their way in men's fields. You know, women who were working in law and film and advertising and engineering. All fields that are still male-dominated today. So in researching Amelia Earhart, I found that there were a lot of parallels between what she experienced 100 years ago and what women and aviators and honestly the general population are still experiencing today. Now this cocktail also comes from 100 years ago. It's a reimagining of a popular drink from the 1920s called an aviation. An aviation is a gin-based drink with citrus, cherry, and floral notes. The floral notes come from a liqueur, creme de violet. Our cocktail is going to try to hit the same notes, but with a little twist. So we're going to start by filling our cocktail shaker up about halfway with ice. And then we are going to add our lemon juice. We're adding 3/4 ounce of lemon juice, which is just the same as we would do in an original aviation cocktail. Then we're going to add some gin. Now, I am adding a special gin. I'm adding a blackberry infused gin. It's just as much for the taste, which is very subtle, as it is for the color, because I want to get this nice, bright fuchsia color. So I'm adding 2 ounces of my gin. And again, all of that is the same as the original aviation. The twist comes later. Now, a twist that I didn't see coming in Amelia Earhart's story is that she went to college and then dropped out after only a year to become a nurse, actually. She wanted to tend to the boys who she saw coming home from World War I. While serving as a Red Cross nurse in Toronto in 1918, Amelia contracted Spanish flu. She had a full year of convalescence at her sister's home, which she spent reading poetry and studying mechanics and learning to play the banjo. Just like everyone on my Facebook newsfeed, learning to play the guitar this week. It was also around this same time that Amelia fell in love with flying. She saw an ace World War I flyer at an exhibition in Toronto, and she was hooked. She dropped out of college for a second time and decided to buy a plane, like you do, with money that she cobbled together from weird day jobs like being a secretary and being a photographer, and then a little bit of money from her mother's inheritance. She named her yellow plane Canary and sought out female flight instructors. She found Nita Snook, whose own resume was incredibly impressive. She was the first woman to own a commercial airfield and in 1921 became the first woman to enter a man's air race. In 1922, Amelia achieved her own first when she rose to 14,000 feet, higher than any woman had ever flown before. We are going to add some rose to our cocktail in place of the creme de violet. We're going to add just a little bit because it goes a long way, about 1/4 ounce. And then we're going to add 1/2 ounce of our cherry brandy, which comes in place of the maraschino liqueur found in an aviation. Lastly, we're going to add an egg white just for texture. Remember, you know, using egg whites in a cocktail comes with risks. It can be dangerous. Pasteurized is best if you have access. Now, danger was an inherent part of the business of aviation in the 1920s, which only made the whole endeavor that much more enticing to Amelia. So in 1928, just 1 year after Charles Lindbergh made his solo flight across the Atlantic, the search was on for a woman to make the same journey. And Amelia was up for it. By journey, I don't mean actually piloting the plane, however. In 1928, Amelia was a passenger in George Stultz's transatlantic flight, and she kept the flight log. This trip got her a ticker tape parade in Manhattan, a reception with President Calvin Coolidge, and earned her the nickname Lady Lindy. Again, just a passenger. Now, there are a lot of pieces out there about whether or not Amelia Earhart was a good pilot. From my very limited research, it seems like she was an okay pilot. She flew in like a lot of contests and always came in third or fourth. I am in no way an expert on this. I can't get like paper airplanes to fly. However, there are two things that I think Amelia Earhart was undeniably great at. First of all, she was an incredible supporter of women. She boycotted any race that didn't allow women to participate, going so far as refusing to fly actress Mary Pickford to the Ben Dix Trophy race because they wouldn't allow women to participate. She helped found the 99s, an organization that still exists and supports female aviators. She forged a lot of friendships with other lady pilots like Ruth Nichols and Jacqueline Cochran. Her friendship with Eleanor Roosevelt may have influenced other feminist beliefs that she held, including her support of the Equal Rights Amendment, which was originally lobbied for by Alice Paul in like 1921 and still exists and still hasn't passed. Can you like even believe that fact 100 years ago? What were we talking about? Amelia Earhart. Okay, so Amelia was also excellent at publicity. She saw these records that needed beating and she just tackled them. And then she shouted from the rooftops. She had multiple brand partnerships, like a line of luggage with her initials emblazoned on it. She wrote articles about female aviators and her own experiences with aviation for magazines like Cosmopolitan, which was a family magazine at the time. And she toured colleges speaking on these subjects. The OG TED Talk. Now, this wasn't just vanity, but it was also a recruiting technique to get more women pilots to take to the skies. The records that she broke include being the first woman to fly solo across the Atlantic, not just as a passenger, but flying in 1932. That same year, she became the first woman to fly across the continental United States. And then in 1935, she became the first person, the first aviator at all, to fly from Hawaii to California. Between 1930 and 1935, she set 7 different aviation records in speed, elevation, and distance. In 1937, she announced her greatest feat yet. She was going to be the first woman to circumvent the globe in an airplane. Now, other people had already flown around the world, but Amelia was choosing a route that was longer than any route that had been flown before, 29,000 miles along the equator. In her first attempt, she departed from California and moved west towards Hawaii. From Hawaii, the intention was to go to Howland Island, a tiny little island in the middle of the Pacific, only about a mile long. However, she never left Hawaii. There was an issue with her takeoff, and she never got off the ground. It was sort of controversial because journalists at the time thought that perhaps her landing gear had faltered or she blew a tire, but others who observed it believed that it was pilot error. So, she had another attempt just a few months later. This time, she decided to travel from east to west, in part because of changing weather patterns at the time. She began in California again, flew to Miami, and then went to South America, to Africa, to Asia, traveling 22,000 miles by the time she landed in New Guinea. This was the final leg of her journey, 7,000 miles across the Pacific Ocean, from New Guinea to Howland Island, from Howland Island to Hawaii, and from Hawaii to California. Landing on Howland Island was arguably the hardest part of the whole journey just because of the size of the island. But Amelia and her navigator, Fred Noonan, were aided by several naval ships that were near the island, guiding them towards its location. They set out on July 2nd into the clouds above. Now, we're going to shake and strain this cocktail. The reason we added the egg white is because I wanted to give it that foamy cloud effect right on top of the cocktail. Gotta give it a good shake to make sure the egg whites are really whipped up. There they go. That nice foam on the top. Now, it wasn't the weather that stopped Amelia from completing her journey. It was the communication, perhaps, the navigation, and just the fact that they were running out of fuel and they couldn't find a place to land. They continually radioed distress signals, but when those signals stopped, an exhaustive naval search began, with ships scouring the Pacific Ocean looking for any evidence that Amelia and Fred had survived, any evidence they had crashed. But there was nothing. They were just lost. Now, I find the story of Amelia Earhart so poignant right now because I feel like it underscores a lot of what many of us are going through. We're out there flying solo and feeling a little lost. I mean, I'm not trying to be dramatic. It's not like we're falling out of the sky and into the ocean, but it just underscores these constancies in the human condition. You know, the loneliness of isolation and the desire to conquer the unknown, the hope of being found. Let's try our drink. It's nice. It's timeless. It's a nod to those 20s cocktails that's still delicious and relevant today, like Amelia. Amelia Earhart worked so hard to break boundaries for female pilots 100 years ago. But how successful was she? I mean, the first female commercial airline pilot wasn't hired until 1973. Even now, less than 5% of all pilots in the United States are women. I mean, we all know about Amelia Earhart and her fateful flight. Could you name another aviatrix besides the one in our glass? Well, I hope that you enjoyed this episode of Feminist Cocktail Hour. I'm going to be back tomorrow. I'm going to have another lady, another libation. Until then, cheers.
Let's go, girls.